Hi, my name is Jessica Reilly, and I am the chair of the Medfield School Committee. And I'm here to basically do an update on what our schools are doing right now, what our budget looks like for the fiscal year 22. And really wanted to kind of bring Dr. Marsden in to this conversation this week so that we could really get a well-rounded understanding of budget, of how we're bringing kids back in, and any plans we have over the summer for the future around some of the grants and funding that might be coming in.
Hi, I'm Jeff Marsden. I'm your superintendent of schools. Happy to be here. Really pleased that our students are now full in person in pre-K through 12. I know it was a long process, and we started bringing students back in January. And our last group of kids came back right before April vacation at a high school, well above the requirements of the state. So we're real happy that we had the cooperation of our families, our teachers, and also our Board of Health that supported us through this process.
Last night at the President's joint address to Congress, House Representative Auchincloss invited Dr. Marsden to be his guest, because Medfield has been able to get the highest level of pool testing across the state. Is that correct?
It is, yes. Our participation rates are phenomenal.
So it essentially puts us ahead of most of the country in terms of that. And the representative has been really interested in how that has worked and what it is that we have been able to do as a community. And I think that we've all acknowledged that it is the effort of every single member of the community and a level of trust in our schools and a trust that we want to have kids back in. But I do think that we shouldn't underplay that our district and the efforts of our district have really been recognized nationally. And for the first time, I think that Medfield High School was mentioned on the floor of the House of Representatives in April. So that's really exciting. And it's just an addendum, but it is kind of indicative of how intensely we have wanted our kids back in.
I think the representative came to visit us 3 weeks ago and got to see exactly what we do with pool testing. And as I said that day, and I said again yesterday, it really is a celebration of our nurses and the great work that they did. You know, we signed up for the program, but they really developed a great plan, implemented it. Our kids were really, our kids participated at a rate that is much higher than anywhere else in the state. We're over 80% right now at the high school. Our staff, over 90% participating. So we've recently expanded the pool testing to our elementary schools. So now we're doing grades 4 and 5, and we're gonna assess that in a few weeks and see whether or not we bring it down to grades 2 and 3. But it's really been an outstanding process. It allows us to really get a surveillance of if the virus is in our schools, and if it is, what we can do about it. But it gives a great peace of mind to not only families, but our teachers, that we are looking to see if the virus is in our schools and then taking action if we find it.
And that there's a flexibility to it as well. That one of the things that has really helped us is that we are also able to do immediate, rapid by next testing. So that if we do identify a pool, we get those results
within 15
back
minutes.
Yeah, within 15 minutes.
In the last 2 days, we've had 2 positive pools, because after April vacation, we made the decision to test twice a week because we know that a lot of families traveled and wanted to make sure that our students and staff were safe. So in order to do that, we needed to order additional tests, and the company that we work with has been great. So we did testing this week at the high school. We had a positive pool yesterday, a positive pool this morning. I just learned both of those. One was 5 students, one was 10 students in the pool. We tested all those students, identified the positive student, removed them from the school, and that's how the program is supposed to work. We wanted to make sure that we can get it very quickly in our school so we don't have in-school spread. So the design of the program has worked in what the congressman has called the Medfield model, in which he mentioned on the floor of the House, because what he saw was that it was just a great representation of how a community can work together to keep kids in full time, use the science, use the evidence base that we have out there to keep kids in school. So I think it's been a real privilege to work with him, but I think it's nice to get the recognition from this community, because it really has been a community effort.
One of the interesting things that I heard on your Facebook Live chat with Representative last night was his and our kind of mutual interest in pre-K access for all. And I wonder if we want to kind of talk now about some of the funding that might be coming down the pike that would be kind of extra budgetary beyond what we would ask for a town meeting. And then we can talk a little bit about the budget for fiscal year 22.
Sure. So beginning last year, we started to receive federal funds from the federal government to help with reopening of schools and keeping kids in school. And the CARES Act was one that the town got that we didn't get as a school district, but we worked closely with the town and were able to access some of those funds for reopening of our schools. Then there was ESSER 1, ESSER 2, and ESSER 3. ESSER 1 was very, very small for Medfield, only $20,000. ESSER 2 was, again, fairly small for Medfield, about $176,000. And then ESSER 3, which we haven't had the allocation yet, ESSER 3 is going to be a little bit more, hopefully over $400,000. And that will be used for us to help with the reopening of school again in September, and then look at some programming that we might need. Like, for instance, we're looking right now is doing a second year of boot camp in our district so that kids would have the opportunity that we, ones that we identify, would have the opportunity to come in and do additional support for language arts, mathematics, either a 4 or 8 week session, depending on the interest, but a way to really try to bolster some of the skills that kids may have lost during the last year or so. You know, one of the things that we talked about last night with the congressman as well is that we have to be careful about the narrative of a lost year with our schools, because it really devalues the work that all of us have done this year and the work that our kids have done. We're doing assessments right now in the district, and we're not seeing, in a general sense, the amount of loss that is supposed to be happening is what the media is putting out there. And we think we have some pretty good reasons for that. One is that early on with our teachers, we had them really truncate the curriculum so that they had to focus on those power standards, the things that that really matter for kids in that particular grade level or that particular course, and really truncate what they were doing to focus on those. And then, you know, in our hybrid model that we started in September, class sizes were really small because only half your class was there. So that really allowed teachers to personalize and get to know kids and work with them on a one-to-one basis much more than they would have in a regular environment when you have 20, 25 kids or so. And then the lessons that they planned on the remote days were engaging enough to keep the learning going as the kids were not in school on those particular days. And then the teacher collaboration is something that I think has been really a positive of this whole pandemic. I think the research has shown over the years, the last 25, 30 years, how important teacher collaboration is. But now that teachers were really forced into it by the pandemic, nationwide, we see that the collaboration has really helped with curriculum planning, assessment, and really instruction. So I think that that's a really important thing that we're going to look at for the summer, is try to identify those kids that may need extra help in those areas, and then we'll use some of those federal funds to support that.
Just to throw you a little bit of a curveball, because I know that we weren't necessarily thinking about talking about this today, but I do know that we are going to be doing MCAS testing this year. But there's a different tenor to MCAS testing this year than there is in other years. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure, that's a really good
point. Because I think there are parents who are concerned that we're putting kids through this, what they consider high stakes testing, but in Medfield is not necessarily particularly high stakes for them or for any child.
Right, so what we're doing, you know, the state is requiring us to have MCAS this year, and there's been a lot of debate about this across the state, at the superintendent level, at the state level. There are lots of folks that don't agree with the fact that we're having MCAS testing at all this year based on the last 13 months. But I think what's happening is that there's a federal requirement to have this testing. So it's not a local or a state decision. It's a federal requirement. But what the state has done to kind of really help us with this situation, knowing what we've all been through in the last 13 months and the fact that our students haven't, I mean, there are many districts that kids just started to get into the classroom now. So they weren't even in a hybrid like we were. They have reduced the amount of questions and the amount of time in MCAS for this year for our students. And that will allow them to really just try to get a baseline, because they want to see from their perspective on the state level, more of a diagnostic exam statewide versus an accountability-based exam, which would kick in all the federal accountability requirements. They've waived that piece of it, but they are going to have the testing that's coming up very soon in May. To look at really a diagnostic to see where we are as a state and compare it to other years so that we can see if there really is truly learning loss, and if there is, you know, what communities really need the extra support to kind of get through that.
And we've always considered MCAS as a very small part of an understanding of how a child is doing in school. It is literally a snapshot. you know, it's certainly good for trending over years mm-hmm. about where a kid is, but it is not by any means, it does not weigh heavily on how we assess kids over the year. I mean, we literally assess them informally almost every day,
sure.
but formal assessments throughout the year. And there are benchmarks that we look towards. So it's not as though MCAS is, in this context, evaluating your child as to how they have done and then putting pressure on them. It is really about trying to understand on a district level as well as a state level where the positives are and where the harm has mm-hmm. come. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really important if we want to speak to parents' anxiety about, you know, like all of a sudden I've heard some people say, well, you know, how could we possibly spend any time on MCAS? How could we possibly spend any time on this? I do say that it is truncated. It is much smaller. It is spread out. And it really kind for many kids comes at the end of the year, at the very end of the year, right? In the high school.
Yeah, I've actually what they decided, the Board of Education decided very recently is last week that our current juniors will not be taking MCAS to graduate. So that, right. you know, they've waived that competency determination test for them. Yeah. I think the real value of MCAS is a data point that they established probably about 6 or 7, well, maybe 10 years ago now, is right. the student growth number.
Right, right.
That's the real value of it. It's really to see where your student falls from year to year. So you get a sense of whether or not there's academic growth in mathematics and language arts and science. So I think that's a really good data point for school districts to use, but it's really gonna be used as a diagnostic this year. And I don't think they're gonna calculate student growth, although they've talked about it. If they do, that's fine too, because I think it's, as I said, an important data point, but we'll see what they decide yeah. once the tests are submitted.
Actually, it would be really quite interesting to see mm-hmm. how that comes out.
Very much.
And again, very little beyond the fact that it is data that allows us to inform ourselves on where we need to concentrate. It does not harm the district and it does not harm any child ever.
No.
So let's swing back to fiscal year 22 and the budget that we're presenting to town meeting, all town meeting, which is at a non-traditional non-traditional time and a non-traditional venue this year. So I think that we really have to help parents understand exactly how important it is that they are there this year.
Right. So we've made, you know, we've had an agreement among the boards about what the school's budget's going to be, which we typically always do at this time prior to town meeting. But nothing's ever official until it's voted on by the town at the annual town meeting. So it's really important for people to go. And if you want to support the school budget, we'd ask for that support. We work really hard this year on a budget that you know, we typically start the process in October, in November. It really ramps up December, January, February, March. You know, you guys in the school committee have really identified those priorities for us, and we've made some changes based on what you think is important for our school district. And we work closely with the warrant committee in the town to get to a number that works for everyone. And I think that the fact that we're going into town meeting with a 3.99% increase is great. It's great for our community, great for our school district. Typically, we have a long list of improvements in different programming that we'd like to do, but that list is very short this year. The budget essentially is the same programs, same people that we have this year, except for what we think is a really important addition, which is a school adjustment counselor right. at the middle school level. So that's the only additional position that we have in the budget this year, but we think it's a very important one. Currently, we have one person working between the high school and the middle school, and we really need to have a full-time person at right. the middle school doing that work.
Right. Especially in the year in which we are coming back full time, in that there has been so much disruption over mm-hmm. the last, you know, 18 months. And for many children, that is this has essentially been their secondary school experience, which is so surprising to me. SEL is going to be, or social emotional learning and a social emotion support is going to be so much a part of what we need to do next year as well. I mean, we've really been focused on it as a district mm-hmm. for quite some time, and I'm so pleased that we have the underpinnings that we're able to build on. But to really be able to kind of make use of that support and hit the ground running is important. Town meeting this year is actually at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on the high school field, socially distanced and incredibly important on May 17th. So that is a Monday. A couple of years ago, we voted in the charter that we would have it the first Monday in May, but we felt that the possibility would still be a little too chilly to get people there. Asked us to push it out to then. I believe the rain date is on May 18th, but it is non-traditional time, and it is very important for parents to come to hear what is happening in the schools, to really think about, and not just parents, but the whole town. We are one of the few places in the world anymore that essentially has our town, our full town of registered voters, as the legislative body of our town. And we continue to be able to do that because we are small enough to do it. I'm thinking we're starting to get just about at the point where it gets complicated, but we have to attend, because if you don't attend, then, and you don't just make it a part of your kind of regular yearly tasks as a citizen, it becomes, you lose a perspective around how the world and the world of Medfield works. And there are things that you will feel as though you did not know about and do not agree with. But if you don't come, you can't vote. And it is one day a year. So bundle up if you need to, or bring your sunscreen, I don't know. But it is so important that you come and lend your voice, not only to the schools and our initiatives, but to everything that is happening in town. This is your one chance per year to really stamp, you know, put your specific stamp, to stand up and say, yes, I do agree with that, with your neighbors. And that's also an incredibly important community building part. It's been my real privilege for the last 19 years almost to be able to sit in that auditorium, or last year the football field, and really know that my neighbors were there to support our town no matter how we felt about it. So,
and if you haven't been to a town meeting, I mean, I've been to many, because I've either worked or lived in different towns in Massachusetts, and it really is something that is unique to Massachusetts. Our town moderator, Scott McDermott, runs an incredible meeting. It's very efficient, and it's not like that all places. So I just want to say that he does that. So it's not something that you'll be bored by. It's definitely a really good meeting to attend, and it's very efficient. And again, lots of important town issues that will be on there that are important to be a part of.
And I always find a perspective that I had not come into town meeting understanding. And I listen to many meetings. I float into many different things. I read almost everything. And I never leave town meeting without being like, oh, I either understand that better, or there is a much different side to that than I would have ever considered. So I think that is a lot of what we're doing here right now. And we're looking forward to the end of the year, to graduation, to rolling rallies,
it's a busy
to celebrations.
Time of year. One of the things we felt was really important this year was to make sure that our seniors had as much as a normal ending to their high school career as we can. And we worked real hard last year for those seniors to have the rolling rally and to have a graduation when other places weren't doing that. And this year we worked just as hard with our kids and our families to have a rolling rally, a picnic. There'll be a senior cruise at the end of the year and a graduation and a prom. So we're real happy about that, because our kids deserve that, and we're pleased that we can provide that for them.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.